When talk turns to what to do about Ukraine, there are many who believe that missile defense may play a role. I'm delighted to have with us to discuss that proposition and more Ricky Ellison. He is the founder and chairman of the Missile Defense Advocacy Alliance. This is a nonprofit organization he launched in 2002 for the purpose of driving for the deployment as well as the development and evolution of missile defenses. And Ricky, it's been too long, but it's good to have you back. Welcome.
Yeah. Thanks, Frank.
So what do you make of this idea that we are facing in Vladimir Putin an adversary that requires really a fundamental reappraisal of and redoubling of effort on our missile defense capabilities?
Well, I think it's the key component for NATO in Article 5. We've used it already at the request of Turkey, and we have to be sensitive to what's going on with Poland and our NATO countries that are on border with Russia. So,
define what you mean by Article 5, because I'm not sure that most of us know what that is under the NATO Charter.
It's a NATO Charter that any country within NATO can request NATO military protection, and that is given to them on request. And Turkey invoked that for the first time when in the Syria crisis, and both U.S., Netherlands, and Germany put their missile defense assets inside of Turkey under Article 5 or NATO.
So when people talk specifically, Ricky Ellison, about responding to Putin's aggression in Ukraine by rebuilding or reinstituting, I guess is a better word for it, the plan that then-President George W. Bush created to deploy limited but nonetheless, powerful anti-missile systems, radars and interceptors in Poland and the Czech Republic. Is that really a runner in your judgment? Is that the kind of response that we should be making at this moment?
Well, number one, the missile defenses that are going in Europe are not for Russia or against Russia. They're built for Iran specifically and the Middle East. Number two is that our president and this administration has conceded our missile defense capability that was planned, starting with George Bush when he first got in, then reducing phase four, eliminating phase four of the European plan, which called for protection of the United States of America, homeland from those sites, which we no longer do. We gave that up last year.
We're visiting with Ricky Ellison. He is the founder and chairman of the Missile Defense Advocacy Alliance, and we're talking about Vladimir Putin's aggression in Ukraine and what the United States and its NATO allies ought to do in response. And Ricky, you were just talking about the European Phased Adaptive Approach, the EPAA, as it was called. This was President Obama's own plan, as I recall, for putting some sort of missile defense in place once he canceled the Bush plan. Even that has apparently now been, not eviscerated, substantially scaled back. Should we be reinstituting phase four, which would, as you said, provide some protection for us as well as the Europeans?
Well, I think it's absolutely essential. We as taxpayers have put a tremendous investment in that capability with not much, or very, very little European support financially for that capability, those two capabilities. And it was a basic premise behind us with the investment by Congress to the president that we would have some sort of protection at the end of it, the United States homeland. That was critical on it. Today, we don't have that because it was eliminated by the president last year.
What was going on there, Ricky? Was this a budget-driven exercise, or is there an ideological effort here, or simple more appeasement of the Russians?
It was a combination of the fact that they didn't think they could get in time by 2020, which they had promised, and they felt that the technical solution that they brought up was now not feasible to put in place there.
Do you agree with that, Ricky, based on your knowledge of the missile defense capabilities that we've been building?
I agree that their concept of having a Aegis-based system and a limited vertical launch tube could not create the velocity to be able to do what it was supposed to do. That is correct. But I do believe that the sensors are just as important, being able to put sensors in that capability to be able to track and discriminate missiles coming over Europe toward the United States should be in those two sites that they're suggesting, which right now we do not. We just have Aegis radar capabilities, which these missiles can fly over.
Now, Ricky, let me switch gears there a little bit, because one of the reasons why we have been talking about putting these missile defenses in place, as you've indicated, was not to provide protection for the Europeans or for us, for that matter, from the Russians, but from Iran. In the interval where this plan has been rejiggered and rejiggered again, the missile threats from Iran seem to have accelerated. We're now being told, as I understand it, that an intercontinental ballistic missile could, in fact, be deployed in Iran, capable of reaching the United States as early as next year. Is that your understanding?
My understanding is that threat continues to grow, and that's why we have to have another forward-based system to complement the two in Alaska and in California to protect the United States of America. And if we can't do it in Europe, we have to do it in the United States, in the eastern United States.
This is the so-called third site.
We have to move on this. If we're not going to go to Europe, let's put it in place, because you're going to have more capability, more protection, which is right now. The United States on the western side of the United States and the central side of the United States is much better protected than the east coast of the United States from a Middle Eastern threat. And that's got to be equalized. We haven't done that.
There's also, as you know so well, Ricky Ellison of the Missile Defense Advocacy Alliance, a problem with the southern approaches to the United States being essentially unprotected as well. Much room for improvement on our missile defenses. Talk, if you would, a little bit about two things, Ricky. One is that the administration, as I understand it, has claimed that there have been technical problems with the ground-based missile interceptor systems, which is justified in part some of their slowing down of the work in that space, and also the effect of budget cuts in this portfolio.
Well, the system today is close to 10 years old, and it was put in very fast, so we have not been able to modernize it, and there are pieces that are becoming obsolescent. So we've had some issues with that, and we have not been very successful with some of our testing intercepts from the current system that we've had. So it's been a big push, and finally we've seen it, that they are going to move away from, or try to move their funding from the regional missile defense capability into our U.S. homeland defense capability. And today they are putting in, I think, close to $600 or $700 million towards a new modernized kill vehicle that's going to go on these GBIs. That's a big shift that we haven't seen before. But I would also state that since the president has been in office, the missile defense budget has consistently declined every single year. So we've had the lowest point that the missile defense budget of the DOD budget has been in since he's been in office. So we're going to have to take funds from something else, it looks like, to be able to support our homeland missile defense, which has to be done.
We're speaking with Ricky Ellison of the Missile Defense Advocacy Alliance. And Ricky, at the very moment that these sorts of cuts and slowdowns and other difficulties have been taking place, we are hearing not just advances in the Iranian missile program, but both the Russians and Chinese are developing new capabilities, some of which seem very explicitly, in fact, they claim are very explicitly designed to defeat our missile defenses. Talk a little bit about maneuvering warheads and specifically hypersonic delivery systems, and how our missile defenses must be improved to contend with those.
So currently, most of our ballistic missile threats go through a ballistic trajectory, which we can mathematically take into account and figure out the algorithms to intercept those missiles. That's what we're good at. That's what we've proven. So the opponents are now shifting to maneuverable warheads that do not do a ballistic trajectory, do an asymmetrical maneuverable thing inside the atmosphere. And they're doing it with great speeds with the hypersonic, which goes up real fast and comes down and then maneuvers at great speeds on that. So that's what the counter is. But missile defense can also counter that very, very effectively, I believe, because we still know where those missiles are going to end up at some point, and their maneuvering is very limited at those high speeds. You'd be able to do one or two maneuvers, and that's about it. But we're able, and I think our technologies are able, to still be able to adjust to that at a terminal inside the atmosphere missile defense capable system.
All right. Well, we'll be watching this closely, as I know will you, Ricky Ellison. We have to let it go at that. Thank you very much for joining us today. As always, keep up the great work that you do with the Missile Defense Advocates Alliance, and come back to us soon if you would. Paul Kenger is next. We'll talk a bit with him about the Reagan approach to the Ukraine crisis. What would the Gipper do? Straight ahead.